Let's wrap up this section about the precise definition of a limit by looking at how a precise definition can be applied to infinite limits. So let's take a look. So remembering where we're coming from is probably a good place to start, actually. Remember that if we use this notation, that the limit of a function as x approaches a, or it could be that it's directional, the limit as x approaches a from the left, of some function, so a limit of a function as x approaches a from the left, or the limit of a function as x approaches a from the right. If we get plus or minus, or if we say plus or minus infinity, what that is doing is that is capturing the behavior that the function is, and this is kind of just shorthand, making it quick here, the function is growing or decreasing, growing, that's our positive infinity, or decreasing, that's when we use negative infinity to describe that behavior. It's growing or decreasing without bound, right? Okay, so that's what we've used so far, and we've used it in the context of vertical asymptotes, and we've looked at it graphically, and we've even looked at how to compute it using some algebraic techniques. So here we go. This would be like a function here, let's call this value a, and so for this particular function, let's call it h of x, we would be saying that the limit as x approaches a from the left of h of x is positive infinity, and the limit as x approaches a from the right of h of x is negative infinity, because it grows without bound coming from the left of that a, and it decreases without bound coming from the right side. So there you go. So that's where we're coming from. That's what we have. That's our intuitive description. That's our intuitive definition, I guess, of what we've been working with limits, infinite limits. And now we're going to take that and we're going to say, well, what would that mean using our precise knowledge now, what we've come from, we've now have a precise definition for a limit as we approach a, if that limit has a finite value, well, how do we apply it for these infinite limits? How does a precise definition, what is a precise definition for these infinite limits? So here it is. It's and you might want to freeze the frame, take some notes on this. This is the precise definition, and this is what it's going to say. So rather than having an epsilon here, we're going to work with some positive number, any positive number, so that that positive number can get as big as we want. So we're going to start off exactly the same way as we have up to this point, that we have a function is defined on some open interval that contains a number a, except possibly at x equals a, because again, that's not where we're focused. We're focused at what happens as we get arbitrarily close, infinitely close to a. So then we say that the limit of a function as x approaches a is infinity, and write this notation that we just described, if for every positive number, so for every positive number, meaning this can get as big as we want, and when I say that, that means it gets infinitely, can get, I guess is how we should write that, this can get infinitely big, okay, right? Because we say any positive number, no restriction. So for every positive number m, there exists a delta greater than zero such that if an absolute value x minus a is less than delta, then f of x will be greater than m, okay? So that means that we can create a delta neighborhood, a delta neighborhood around a, such that the function will get arbitrarily big. So that the function gets this idea that we've used intuitively, but now we're cleaning it up. So that means that given any number m, we can make a delta neighborhood so that the points in that neighborhood are as big as we want. Okay, so it gets arbitrarily, that's that idea of it getting arbitrarily big. It's hard for me to write the word arbitrarily. There's a lot of letters. There we go. Arbitrarily big. A lot of letters. It's hard to write that and try to spell that correctly while also speaking. So let's skip that in there. Okay. So that's what it means to grow without bound, to have a limit of infinity, meaning we grow without bound as we approach a. And of course, on the other side of that, we've written this up as if we were looking at a limit going to positive infinity. But of course, the exact opposite scenario would say this, that the limit of a function f of x as x approaches a is negative infinity if for every negative number there exists a delta greater than zero, such that as long as x minus a, right, the distance between x and a is less than delta, then f of x will be less than this negative number. So what that means is that this can get infinitely negative. I should have said up here, this gets infinitely big in a positive way, and in this scenario, this can get infinitely big magnitude-wise, but in a negative way. Okay, so our negative infinity, positive infinity. Okay, so how do we then apply this when we are actually looking at a definition? So let's look at this. How do we actually apply this definition in a proof? And let's do this guy right here. Let's prove that the limit of the function 1 over x minus 3 to the 4th as x approaches should actually be positive 3 there. Let me fix that. Okay, so I just got a little typo in my typed up version there. But let's do this. Let's prove using the precise definition that this statement is true. So the limit as x approaches 3, that was where I had the mistake. It shouldn't have been negative 3. It should have been positive 3. So the limit of this function, 1 over the quantity x minus 3 to the 4th power as x approaches 3, is growing without bound. So we want to show that this grows without bound, which is what it means, right? That's what we're saying when we say that this limit is equal to infinity. It means that this function grows without bound. Now notice that this is non-directional. So of course that means that this happens from both directions, okay? As it would, because notice this little 4th power right here. So we do know and we can show, right, that this as x approaches 3, that this piece here is approaching 0. Now, if it approaches it from the left, it would be approaching 0 in a negative way, 0 from the left side. If we were approaching 3 from the right side, it would also be approaching 0 from the right side or 0 from the positive side. And so we would have either a 0 with a negative or a positive here, depending on which direction we were looking at it approaching 3. But when we raise it to the 4th power, right, regardless of which direction we come to 0, it is going to approach a positive, approach 0 from the positive side, from the right side. So this will be positive infinity from both directions. Okay, I just wanted to mention that because it is non-directional, but we should always take a pause for a second and think about why is it infinity on both sides of 3, and that's because of that 4th power on the x minus 3. All right, just so that I have some lines here, I've carried it over here so that we can do this problem over here. So take this here, and we're going to start with the statement. Okay, so whenever we prove limits, so proving limits using a precise definition, there's always going to be two steps. We got to do some side work first to figure out what our delta should be. And then we're going to come back and we're going to plug it in a really nice, concise way as a proof. So proving limits using a precise definition, we're going to use two steps. I just classify them as side work. And I do my side work to figure out what I need to define delta to be, and then I come back in and I do my proof. So those are going to be our two steps. So we'll start with the side work. And when we start with the side work, what we're going to do first is we're going to say, well, what do we need? Using that precise definition, what do I need to find? So given any m greater than 0, so given any positive number, any positive number. Remember, m can be any positive number. M can be any positive number. So our side work, right, is we're working with what we want to come up with what we need to write the proof. So given any m greater than 0, we need to find a delta greater than 0 such that if x, oh, I've lost my limit. Where's my limit? My a value is 3 because I'm approaching, x approaches a, and this is obviously my function, right? So x minus 3, such that if x minus 3 is less than delta, then my function will be greater than m. So then 1 over x minus 3 to the fourth will be greater than this m, any m. Remember that it is any m. I'm noticing that I didn't maybe give myself enough room for my side work, so I'm going to move my second step over just a little bit. Okay, so there we go. So this is what we're actually going to work with. This is what we want. That's the end. That needs to be the end result of my proof. So that's what's kind of funky about the side work, right? Like, we have to actually work backwards from what we want to figure out what we need to write the proof. So it feels like we kind of go backwards and then we go forwards through the proof. So that's that feeling of kind of like, well, I feel like I'm kind of going backwards. Like, that's what I need. But that is how we have to start. We have to start with what we need and work our way backwards so we can figure out what to plug into the proof. So that's what we're going to start with. We're going to start at 1 over x minus 3 to the fourth being greater than m. And then I'm just going to use what I know about inequalities and algebra, you know, all my tools. I'm going to pull out all my tools out of my toolbox here. Maybe not all of them, but some of my tools out of my toolbox here. And I notice here that, again, I'm trying to find a delta, right? And I notice something that is similar to my delta statement that I'm going to need up here. I see this little x minus 3. So I start thinking, well, how can I manipulate this? Well, I could start by just reciprocating both sides of this inequality. And when I do that, that flips the inequality. So this becomes less than 1 over m. So x minus 3 to the fourth power, when I take 1 over x minus 3 to the fourth power and I reciprocate it, then that's going to exactly flip the inequality. So that flips. So I flip, I reciprocate this, and I flip this, the inequality. Okay? All right. And then I can take the fourth root of both sides. And I can do that. It will leave me with, because again, we don't know if this is positive or negative. So when I take the fourth root, an even root of an even power, I am left with the absolute value. So I'm left with the absolute value of x minus 3 right there. And that has to be less than the fourth root of 1 over m. And might as well just clean that up a little bit more. X minus 3 has to be less than 1 over the fourth root of m. Okay. So turns out if my function is going to be greater than m, then the quantity x minus 3 has to be less than 1 over the fourth root of whatever that number m is. So if I want my function to be greater than 10,000, then the quantity x minus 3 has to be less than 1 over the fourth root of 10,000. Okay, so that said, that is exactly what I need. I just found a bound for my delta. So I just found delta. So we just found delta. So what we can do here is we can use that to define our delta. So we can say we should let delta actually be less than or equal to 1 over the fourth root of whatever m is. Okay? So that's how we can define delta. If we do that, if I guarantee that delta is less than that value or equal to, I mean, we could say equal to. I always like to put the less than or equal to. If you prefer to just use the equal to, that will give you the correct delta neighborhood. But I always like to put the less than or equal because it is true that it can actually be less than that too. Of course, if it's even smaller than, you know, the minimum value it has to be, then it's even more, you know, it's even more like, you know, it's even more of a guarantee that we're in the right neighborhood. We're just even more restrictive. Okay. That is our side work. Now we need to put it together into the proof. So this is the part where it feels like we're going to have to kind of work our way a little bit backwards here, but we're going to use that delta and we're going to write up the proof. So our proof is going to start just like this. We're going to say, given any m greater than 0. Now we're going to say let delta be less than or equal to 1 over the fourth root of m. And that's the piece that we had to use this side work to come up with. Okay, so we're using our side work in the first line of our proof. We need to know what delta should be based on any given m. And so that's why we had to do the side work to figure that out. Okay. All right. So given m greater than 0, that's what we're going to let our delta be. And then we're going to write it up. Okay. So I'm going to zoom in here so I have a little more space. And we're going to write up our proof. Then if x minus 3 is less than delta, and this is where we're going to show that this will be true. Okay? We're going to show that that will be true. And in a lot of ways, it feels kind of funny because we actually have to work our way like backwards. We have to work our way back up through all the side work that we did. And so that's what we're going to do over here in the proof. That's what I was saying, was it feels funny because it feels like we go backwards and then forwards, right? And that's now we're going forwards through the proof. Okay. So if this is true, then it must be the case that the quantity x minus 3, and I can drop the absolute values because of the even power. So even though, you know, I could keep those absolute values in there, but it's not necessary because I'm raising it to the fourth power. So I can drop the absolute values and just say x minus 3 to the fourth power would have to be less than delta to the fourth power, right? Well, but that has to be based on how we've defined delta, right? That has to be less than or equal to 1 over the fourth root of m to the fourth, okay? Simply just using how we've defined delta, and our x minus 3 has to be less than delta. That's what we said here. If it is less than delta, then the quantity x minus 3 to the fourth has to be less than 1 over m. Okay. Pause there for a second. Now we can use our algebra and we can reciprocate both sides of this inequality, which will flip the inequality. And then thus 1 over x minus 3 to the fourth has to be greater than m over 1. But m over 1 is just m. So I will write it as just m. And that's it. That's my proof. Boom. Right? Put my explanation marks right there. Yay. I've got my proof. I have shown that given any m, as long as I choose delta to be less than or equal to 1 over the fourth root of m, my function is going to be greater than that m value. And so I'm going to go ahead and finalize the proof with my therefore statement. So I can say, therefore, if the quantity x minus 3, we've just proven it, is less than delta, where delta is less than or equal to 1 over the fourth root of m, then 1 over x minus 3 to the fourth will be greater than m. And there it is. That is my proof. Okay. I've shown that it doesn't matter what m is. M can be 5 billion. M can be 27 trillion. As long as I let delta be 1 over the fourth root of whatever m is, then I can find a neighborhood. It'll be a super tiny neighborhood, a very small delta neighborhood on the x-axis. But as long as the points are in that delta neighborhood, the function will be greater than any given m that I choose. Okay? I'm going to zoom all the way out so you guys can see the two steps again. But remember, that is the process when we're doing our precise definitions. You got to go through some work thinking of what you actually want, right? This is what we wanted. Right? This is what we need or want. And so in our side work, we start with that and we work our way to a place where we can actually define delta. Okay. Once we've got that, we have everything we need to just set up a very nice, it's a beautiful little proof. So we can set up a nice little proof once we know what we should define delta to be. But you got to do that side work first. Okay. So do the side work and then write up the nice proofs.